Been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Good evening and welcome to East Peckham Salvation Army Corps. You're all very welcome, whether you're long-standing or whether you've just joined us. We're a big family here at East Peckham, and we go along with what William Booth said so many years ago, that whosoever will may come. And our doors, well, not quite at the moment, but are always open, wide, and all are welcome to join in. Today is a wonderful, special day. It's our birthday. Happy birthday to all of you. Whit Sunday, or Pentecost Sunday, is the day that we celebrate and remember the Holy Spirit descending on the disciples, and then that wonderful sermon that Peter made. And how the Spirit moved among the people, and how many people on that one day were saved. Wonderful, wonderful memories and wonderful Bible readings as well. We're not going to read that tonight, but do afterwards go away and find it for yourself and read through. Wonderful, wonderful things. So do sign in if you're with us. Don't be shy. I'm still finding people who don't sign in. It's so lovely to know that you're with us. And we also like to pray for you as we go through the week as well. So let us know you're here. A little bit of chat is a lovely thing. It's something we're all missing, the fellowship with each other. So do sign in and use the chat button there just to have a little chat or ask for such a prayer or whatever is necessary. Please do that. Let's be one. Let's be a family together. Well, let's move on to our worship, and we're going to start, as we always do, with prayer. Prayer is just so wonderful and so important, and there's so many things going on at the moment that we need to take to God in prayer, to take us there and to set our minds in the right place, to get the attitude of prayer in our headset. We're going to listen to the International Staff Songsters singing the most beautiful, beautiful song called The Well Is Deep. I hope you'll enjoy this, and then we'll pray together.
Thank you.
Let's pray together, shall we? Mighty God, we remember this day with awe and wonder. We remember the events of that day of Pentecost so long ago, which so transformed the lives of the apostles. Move in us today, we pray. We remember how, in the space of a few moments, their experience was revolutionized. Their expectations was turned upside down. Their attitudes changed forever. One moment consumed by fear, the next radiating confidence. One moment uncertain of the future, the next sure of their calling. One moment wrestling with doubt, and the next full of faith. One moment hiding behind locked doors, and the next preaching boldly in the crowds. Lord, move in us like that, we pray. Mighty God, you came through your Spirit, and life was never to be the same again. Come to us, breathe new fire into our hearts, new energy into our lives, new life into our souls. Transform our fear, our anxiety and doubt. Fill us with confidence and faith. Open our minds to new horizons, new experiences, and a new way of looking at life. And so may we live by your Spirit, bearing rich fruit to your glory. Lord, move in us today, we pray. We have rejoiced today about the gift of your Spirit, the way you breathe new hope and new faith and new life in your people. But we remember also that not everyone responded so gladly for the Spirit's coming. For some there was scorn, ridicule and disbelief, suggestions that the apostles were drunk or even out of their minds. Lord, have mercy on thoughts like that. Living God, forgive us that we too can be guilty of similar response. Instead of welcoming your Spirit, we greet him with cautious and maybe suspicious hearts. Instead of opening our lives to the Spirit's movements, we close our mind to anything which challenges our long-held preconceptions. Instead of gladly receiving your Spirit's gifts, we barricade our souls against change. Lord, have mercy on us. Living God, you warned us to test what we think is the Spirit and ensure that it is you. And there are times when we need to do this. There are times when it is right, though, to be in awe. It is time to be sure that we do not have misplaced enthusiasm and that we refuse false prophecy. Lord, save us from ever quenching, ever obstructing or frustrating your true Spirit. Forgive us all the times that we have done that, and open our lives now to your Holy Spirit's life-giving breath, that we may live more truly as your people. We make our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Saviour. And we think now, Lord, of our community, the place that we live, the people around us, those that we call family and friends. Lord, we pray that you'll be in any problems that there are, and that you will give strength and healing, and we pray that your will be done. We think particularly, Lord, here of Stuart, who has spent way too much time, he will tell you, in hospital. But we pray, Lord, that they will find the problem and that they will put it right. We put trust in your medical staff, the skills that you have given mankind, that he may be back with us soon. We also think, Lord, of Jenny with her ongoing treatments. We think of Lydia and Neil as they make their lives together, getting over the issues and problems that they have. And we think of Wendy and George as George comes back from having a pacemaker fitted. We pray, Lord, that their lives will get back to normal as soon as possible. And we think, Lord, of our ongoing problems with this COVID. We're worried about the future still. New strains keep coming up. Things are up and down. Lord, we pray that those that lead us will lead us sensibly, and that we'll think of people's health and welfare before they think of the economy, before they think of money. Lord, we pray that all this is in your hands, and all this be your will. And we pray that you will continue to give us the strength to be your people in this world at this time, showing your love, showing your forgiveness, and being there for those that need you. Remember that our hands are your hands, and that our feet are yours. We make our prayers through the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Saviour. And we say together the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And let's sing again, let's worship again. This is a much more modern tune, a Matt Redman song that is really taking off on all the churches now, and it's a lovely song. It's called 10,000 Reasons. Let's sing and let's praise God together.
Worship.
Our scripture reading tonight comes from Romans 5, and I'll be reading for the New International Version from verse 1. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which now we stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. You see, just at the right time, when we were still powerless, God died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: whilst we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Amen. May God help us to understand these words to us this evening. And it's that time again. You seem to like these action songs. Well, I'm running out. I'm going to have to record some, I think, soon. But this is one we haven't done before. So I hope you're feeling limbered up and ready for a little bit of fun. This is a very old one too, actually. This is Father Abraham. Now, please, if you're going to get up and do the actions, which I hope you will, don't fall over. It's been done many times. Enjoy Father Abraham together. Indeed, all sons of Abraham. And not only Christianity, but many other of the major religions of the world look at themselves as sons of Abraham. Interesting thoughts there. I'll leave that one with you. Let's sing again a song we all know and love. To God be the glory, great things he has done. Sing up nice and loud, never mind the neighbours. let them enjoy it too. We're thinking tonight of chosen, changed, and cleansed. So how have we been chosen, changed, and cleansed by our God on this Pentecost Sunday? I hope we have been. To focus our thoughts, let's start with a single verse from a letter written by the Apostle Peter to the followers of Christ who were living in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. For those of us who are not great on biblical geography, it's roughly the area we know today as Turkey. Peter was writing to Christians who had been scattered far from home, some because of persecution, some because of circumstance. Peter was writing to encourage people who were lonely, afraid, or discouraged. These words that Peter wrote so long ago are an enormous encouragement to us today. So these are the words from 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 2. God the Father knew you and chose you long ago, and his Spirit has made you holy. As a result, you have obeyed him and have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. May God give you more and more grace and peace. What wonderful words from Peter. Even that last line, may God give you more and more grace and peace. And I say that to you, each and every one of you tonight. May God give you more and more grace and peace. So there are three things I want to draw to your attention. Firstly, God the Father chose you. And I'm talking to you as an individual person. Yes, you may be a mother or a father or a daughter or a son or a grandma or a grandfather, but this is you. God chose you. Secondly, God, the Holy Spirit, changes you. And I'm still talking to you as an individual. And thirdly, God the Son cleanses you, the individual. As important as our families are, when it comes to dealing with God, it's you and only you that matters here. So firstly then, God the Father chose you. Ephesians 1 tells us, even before he made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in his eyes. What an amazing verse that is. There's so many amazing verses in the Bible. We have been chosen. You have been chosen. And I have been chosen. Chosen because of God's love for us, even before he made the world. I can't remember what happened in 1066, let alone right back then, and yet God had chosen me. We are special to him. We belong to his family. We are children of the living God. God, of course, is eternal. God has given us free will, yet he knew who would willingly repent and turn to him. In all things, especially in our salvation, God is sovereign. He knew who would believe. He knew who would know their need of a saviour. God the Father knew everything and everyone, even before he spoke the universe into existence. Now I say these words, but to comprehend them is quite another matter. We're not talking about trivial things here. You and I, and all who have faith in the one true God, are loved and chosen to be the people of God. 2 Timothy chapter 2 reminds us, God's truth stands firm like a foundation stone with this inscription, the Lord knows those who are his, and all who belong to the Lord must turn away from evil. The Lord knows those who are his, and all who belong to the Lord must turn away from evil. If you are a Christian, if you have repented from your sins, if you trust in Jesus as your Lord and Saviour, then you have been loved and chosen by God. We are saved by God's love and mercy. We are set free from the penalty for our sins and assured of a place in heaven. All because of God's love for us. Choosing to accept Jesus as Lord and Saviour changed our lives. We are in this world, but as followers of Christ, we are not to be of this world. Remember the prayer of Jesus in John 17? In verses 14, he prayed, I have given them your word, and the world hates them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from the evil one. They do not belong to this world any more than I do. Make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is truth. Just as you sent me into the world, I am sending them into the world. Who are them then in that prayer? Them. Are the disciples of Christ them? Are you and me them? God has chosen you for a purpose. God has a specific plan for you. You have a reason to be in this world. You have a destiny. Not of the world. We make different choices. We live differently. We act differently because God has chosen us, and we, of our own free will, have chosen Christ. Slightly odd, because we are in church on a Sunday morning instead of at a boot fair or playing football. Odd because instead of enjoying your Sunday evenings relaxing, you willingly turn on your device and join with others to sing and worship and listen to me telling you about God. You deserve a medal. Second point. God the Holy Spirit changes you. God the Father knew you and chose you long ago, and his Spirit made you holy. The New International Version says, sanctified by the work of the Spirit. The Oxford Dictionary defines sanctified as set apart or declared holy. Consecrated means freed from sin or purified. As disciples of Christ, we are set apart for God's purposes in this world. At the moment we give our lives to Christ, we are saved. But there is an ongoing process of change, sanctification, that continues in our lives until God calls us to step into eternity. The Holy Spirit works in us to transform and change us. God wants us to be his holy people. In fact, he commanded to us in 1 Peter, you must be holy because I am holy. The Holy Spirit helps us to be obedient to God. The Holy Spirit will work in us and help us to focus on God's plans and his purpose for us. The Holy Spirit reminds us that we are loved and belong to God. The Holy Spirit reminds us that we are chosen by God. And the Holy Spirit can change and transform us. Here's a question for you. Do you allow the Holy Spirit to change you? I mean, really change you. Your thoughts, your actions, your very words. Do you ever make choices based on what you want rather than what you know God expects of you? Do you allow God some control or full control of your life? The Holy Spirit makes us holy. His presence in us is meant to change us. He can empower us each and every day, not only the easy days, but the hard times, like we're going through at the moment. To live lives that bring honour and glory to God. He can enable us to reflect the character and holiness of God to those around us. Do you want to live a life that reflects the character and holiness of God? Do you want the Holy Spirit to transform you from the inside out? In Romans 12, the Apostle Paul encourages us to let our bodies be a living and holy sacrifice to God. He said this, "This is truly the way to worship God. Don't copy the behaviour and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect." The Apostle Peter reminds us that a Christian is someone who has been set apart, someone who is being made holy, someone who is consecrated for God's purpose. Sanctification is a lifelong process. The Holy Spirit has changed us, is changing us, and will continue to change us so that we can become more Christ-like. Each of us needs the Holy Spirit to daily bring change into our lives and to continue making us holy, to lead us, to guide us, to strengthen us, to empower us. And finally, God the Son cleanses you. God the Father knew you and chose you long ago, and his Spirit has made you holy. Peter tells us because we've been set apart by our obedience to God, we have been cleansed by the blood of Christ. The obedience that Peter is writing about is continuous obedience, living our lives as children of God and disciples of Jesus. Casual, convenient Christianity is not obedience to God. God wants each of us to be wholehearted, not half-hearted or even a quarter-hearted. God wants us to be faithful and not faithless. It's all about commitment. There's that word again. We don't like that word in the 20th century or the 21st century. But this is all about commitment. If we are truly honest with ourselves and with God, each of us know that there have been times in our past when we have chosen our way over God's way. Times when we took the easy option rather than the right option. Times when, instead of standing firm and striving for what God expected and desired of us, we fell short, sometimes well short. For us as Christians, obedience to God is not an optional extra. It's meant to be the way we live our daily lives, hour by hour, minute by minute. In the new covenant God has established with us through the perfect sacrifice of Jesus, we are cleansed. We are set apart and we are pledged to obedience. When we turn to Jesus as Lord and Saviour, when we repent from our sins and ask God to forgive us because of our faith in Jesus, we are saved. Our sins, past, present, and future, are forgiven because Christ shed his blood for us at the cross. He paid the price that we could not pay. He died in our place. Our punishment was put on him, and we were given righteousness. It almost sounds too good to be true. And normally I'd advise, if it sounds too good to be true, it normally is. But this is an exception, because that is indeed what happened. Jesus died for our sins. Are you living a life that demonstrates to God and to others around you that you have given your life to our Saviour? Is your life, is my life, fully set apart for him? Is that evident in our daily lives? God the Father chose you. God the Holy Spirit changes you. And God the Son cleanses you. God loved you then. He loves you now, and he will continue to love you forever. Despite our faults, despite our imperfections, God knows you. He knows me. He loves you. He loves me. May God help us to become the people he has called us. Chosen, changed, cleansed, and committed to discovering our destiny. May God bless you on this Pentecost Sunday as we remember that he sent his Spirit for you and for me. Amen. May God bless his words to us this evening. And let's sing. Let's sing a good song that lets people know exactly what we think and what we believe. A song that's known all across not only the Salvation Army world. A song that I've seen bring people to tears. A song that we should sing from our very souls this evening. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war. onward, Christian soldiers marching as to war with the cross of Jesus going on before. What a wonderful song that is. I hope you sung it out loud and proud this evening. Well, I'm afraid we've come to the end of our worship once again. I hope you've enjoyed worshiping with us. If you haven't signed in yet, you're not too late. You still can. So please do. We'll be back with you next Sunday. And I'll leave you with this benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Good night and God bless you all.